Thank you, Chair, for the kind introduction, and welcome everyone. Just a bit of a deviation. I will be talking something quite different from the previous speaker, and that is advanced batteries and supercapacitors at the CSIR. Just because we are celebrating our 70th year anniversary, thought it is important that I share, you know, with you what we have been doing in the area of energy storage. And maybe since Mike Tucker is here, maybe he will just tell us what he did in the last 20 years in the, when he was here at the CSIR. So I'm just going to mention briefly what he did and what we are doing to complement that area of technology. So in doing that, I will just tell you briefly what is battery, what is supercapacitor. And then I'll give you the general application, the grid scale application. I'm also going to talk about that. And then I'll tell you our R&D and innovation strategy. And then I will briefly share with you what we are doing in the area of value addition to our local raw materials. This morning, the Honorable Deputy President did mention about beneficiation. What is it that we are doing to add value to our huge mineral resources? And the last speaker also did mention that. So, battery and supercapacitor, what are they? Battery, I try to be as simple as possible. When you hear about battery, you are dealing with energy. And when you're talking about supercapacitor, you're talking about power. And I'm going to share with you the differences between the two. Whether you have battery or supercapacitor, this is the way we represent it. Technically speaking, we have a positive plate and we have a negative plate. And then at both plates, you have what we call, at the positive plate, we have what we call cathode material. At the negative plate, we have what we call anode material. And then at the middle, you have what is called separator. Those are the components of a battery or a supercapacitor. But now, let me bring it to real life. When somebody does a long distance travel, if you can do long distance run, say marathon, just like our brother here, Haile Gebrselassie, who is a world champion in 10,000 meters Olympic, you see, he can do long distance. He can do it very gently. But the other guy there is Usain Bolt. This is 100 meters champion. He has a lot of power, but he cannot do this. This one also has a lot of energy, but he cannot do that. So if both of them work, they are all champions. So in a sense, I'm saying that battery and supercapacitor, they all have their own respective roles to play in energy storage application. And then in the market, you see them. This is how you see them in the market. You see batteries, coin cell, battery packs. You find Panasonic. You have, these are the ones that you use in your cell phones and also laptops. Supercapacitors are like that. You also find them. You know, they are described as batteries on steroids. That's the way they are doing. So when you need a burst of energy, what you require is a supercapacitor. If you have an emergency, since we have emergency exits here, you don't need battery to operate your emergency exit doors. You require something that will open up. You want it in second and it opens up. That is why they are used in Boeing's or aeroplane exit windows or doors. That's where you find supercapacitor. That's where they operate. Batteries don't operate in those spaces. Okay, having introduced you to that, they come in different shapes and sizes for several applications, a plethora of applications, and I've listed some of them here. You see, you use them in residential or commercial power. You can use them to store your wind or your solar, as the last speaker did mention. You use them in portable electronics. Also find them in industrial equipment, like people who work in the mines. You find them there. Every one of us here is using something, battery somehow, all of us here. And you cannot deny that. Then we have this in mobility, automotive applications. This is where batteries actually, doing a whole lot of work at the moment. in South Africa, we already have some electric vehicles being run completely by lithium-ion batteries. So those are the areas you find them. Okay. Again, there are other so many applications. There are so many of them. I can't just begin to mention them now. People are using them in thin, flexible printed batteries. In other words, you can have them like in your MasterCard. So when you spend your money or withdraw money, it tells you exactly how much balance that you have. People are already using that now, and there are so many of them I've mentioned here in terms of health, medical devices, smart cards, power backup, energy harvesting, smart packaging, and just to name but a few. Now, what about grid scale application? Where do we find them? They are used in so many areas of grid scale application. In terms of, it's not just storing energy in a solar cell or solar energy or wind energy, then you use them whenever you want. They are beyond that. In terms of grid scale application, we can use them in what they call, these are terminologies that you find in grid scale applications, like price arbitrage, which means you can store, you can use your battery or your storage system to store energy when the energy supply is marginally, the cost of production of energy supply is cheap. Say in the evening when nobody is using electricity, you can then store that, you can store your electricity there, and then during the peak period, you can then use that. You don't use the grid. So you also have what is called industrial peak shaving. There is a penalty. This is for you to avoid penalty because some industries have the maximum amount of electricity they can use. And if they overuse that, they pay a price. They pay a penalty for doing that. So to avoid them paying such penalties, they can store the energy during the off-peak period and then use them during the peak period. Then we talk about frequency regulation. You can use that to, supercapacitors actually are used in frequency regulation because you don't want, you know, fluctuations in the power system is not right. But once you use the energy storage system, you can actually stabilize the grid. I've also said something about island and off-grid storage that you can use. But in South Africa, you don't, most of the homes in South Africa is connected to the national grid. But some other countries, most countries in Africa, would go for island and off-grid storage system. And then there is this one, transmission and distribution upgrade deferral. This is where energy storage can also play a role. Voltage control, just to have a good quality power, you know, system in our grid. Now, this morning, the deputy president did say something about people telling you, you know, just focus on your animals. Focus, don't go about thinking you can do any innovation. And I often hear that also at conferences. They tell you, well, you have all these minerals. Just give us the minerals. We can make the battery. We can make the supercapacitors for you. Why invest in doing innovation like batteries and supercapacitors? Now, in terms of world ranking, you see, this is just for South Africa. We are ranked, these are the critical minerals that are required for developing these systems, batteries and supercapacitors. Manganese is critical, vanadium, titanium, chromium, ruthenium, and you can see that in terms of world ranking, South Africa is number one. In terms of, it's a huge mineral resources. So there is, it doesn't make sense that we don't do research in this area concerning the abundance of minerals. And then the question is, but where is Africa? Where are we in the area of, say, for example, the lithium-ion batteries? I've always, this is something I did some years back when I joined the CSIR. Now, this is, if you look at the geographical distribution of lithium-ion battery patents based on publication between 1970 and 2010, you see that the people, the countries that control this are, okay, you have Europe. No, this is not Europe. Third is Japan, followed by China, and then Korea. 13% is the US, and then Africa does not even appear there. Then I think that when I did this, Morocco had only two patents, and South Africa had 19 patents. Of course, if you do these plots, that I tried everything I could to put this on the map here. It didn't appear. It just refused to appear. So it's even the system couldn't. It's so tiny. It's insignificant to the system. So that is where we were. And I don't think much has changed. We have done some work at the CSIR where we have been able to do some patent, but I don't think it still appears that this is actually, I should see this as current data. Now, again, the motivation, why do we do what we are doing? We look at the government policies and the initiatives. They always mention this. They say the development opportunity of smarter grids and storage solutions, which can help in integrating variable renewable technologies, should also be considered. If you look at that, you find that in our integrated resource plan, also mentioned this morning. We require this renewable energy. You have to have some mix, any effective energy mix for public transportation. When you talk about transportation, modern transportation, you're dealing with electric vehicles, or hybrid electric vehicle, or plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. So that's where we're going to play a role. Then there is this South Africa also. We have this shortage of skills. So there is need to develop skills in that field. Okay. What is our strategy at the moment? The CSIR, we follow four strategies, which we call quadruple combination processes in making the materials that we make. We do doping, nanosizing. We can also surface coat the materials that we make just to make sure that the material is of highest standard. We are also using what is called microwave irradiation, also to improve the properties of the material that we make. I don't want to go into technical details, but just for information, this again, sorry, apologies for this, for people who don't understand, these are some chemical formulas, just pretend as if you didn't see them. But these are some of the critical material that we are working in, we are developing at the CSIR at the moment. We have what we call the LMNO, high energy battery. This was the one that was actually developed. If you look at this one, lithium manganese, this was the very first lithium cathode material that was developed at the CSIR during the time of Mike Thackeray. And this is the cathode material that drives the electric vehicle that we see today, the Nissan Leaf, 100%. That Nissan Leaf is pure electric vehicle. You don't require any petrol. Just enter and you drive. And it is driven by this technology. So there are so many other technologies we are developing. Again, I don't want to waste your time, but we are trying to patent them. We have to protect them as much as we possibly can. Okay. So I'll say that these are the challenges. Yeah. This material, even though it is used in electric car today, at the CSIR, we're still trying to improve the properties of the material. It still has some challenges. Some of them are, you know, the capacity fading. You drive, you before you know it, the energy is gone down. You want to charge it again. You don't want something like that. So our work entails improving the properties, helping the capacity to remain for a long time before you want to charge it again. These are some of the work that we've done. This is one of the PhD students in our group published this work. It has also been patented. Let me just rush these technicals. Again, this is the most current one we are dealing with now. This is a high energy cathode material. We have been asked to, we have a TIA, Technology Innovation Agency, helping us to scale this one up. They say it is going to be the next generation cathode material for electric cars. These are some of the challenges we are facing. We are trying to solve. It is difficult to make a pure material, pure lithium manganese nickel oxide, and again, it is difficult to find the right electrolyte that will help drive that system. So we are trying to find solution to them. We published them also. This is another one. I think my category will talk about this today. It's a high energy material, high energy cathode material. You can now use this if it is properly developed. You can use it to, you know, drive your car for almost about 300 kilometers before you can start thinking about recharging the system. So we are also playing in that part. We have got some materials, just got a RSA patent application on that. But just before I conclude, I want to tell us, you know, what we are doing in terms of value addition to our mineral resources. The minister said this morning, this is a typical material. It's called electrolytic manganese dioxide. This material can never be used for any, you can't use it as is to make any cathode material. But now we are developing strategies to make sure that we can then use this raw material as is to make all these systems we have here, lithium-ion batteries, sodium-ion batteries, supercapacitors, electrocatalysts for metal air batteries, and including fuel cell. This is just an example. You may not understand what is happening here, that this material is impossible to use as is, but we have developed a system where we can get a nanowire out of this. We can make pure manganese 304. This is a very active material. And from there, we can develop these are cathode materials that we are developing at the moment. That's part of our strategy. So we are also making it a scalable production of fluorinated sodium ion battery cathode materials from raw EMD, electrolytic manganese dioxide. Sodium ion batteries are going to be very cheap because if you want to use them for storage, especially for home storage, that's the way to go. Sodium is always everywhere. Any country has got that. So we are focusing on that also. I conclude. This is our new battery lab, our energy storage research laboratory. I think today or tomorrow, some of you will visit us and we'll show you what we are doing at the moment. We'll take you through our labs. And going forward, we want to do this. We've got this. We want to make sure that we're able to make this material, cathode materials, at more than 1 kilogram. Because at the moment, we're making them at the laboratory scale, grammage scale. But now, we can make up to 1 kilogram or more than that. The target is 100 kilograms. And once we do that, we'll be able to develop cells, battery cells or supercapacitor packs, and then we can start the technology demonstration with electric, golf carts, like that. So that is the general plan, and we are already developing a lot of material for doing that. We say LMO, LMNO, and NMC, the high voltage material I told you about. Again, we can have the supercapacitor, we can make all solid states kind of supercapacitor, because for electronic application, you don't want to have battery that has liquid. It destroys your system. So we want to make sure that our electrolyte is no longer going to be liquid. We want to make them solid so that it can be used for electronic applications. And these are some of the examples we showed. This is a very flexible system. You can actually wear it and you can charge it. This is where we have just tested the application. It can light up 1.67 LED. I acknowledge the people who are our collaborators, Department of Science and Technology, this UWC, we're working with them in terms of scaling up the process. Data EMD is the one doing the battery electrolytic manganese dioxide. They gave us that material. We're also working with them as collaborators. And then the universities, NRF, and then these are the team. Some of them, you never get all of them at the same time. This was a picture that was taken about 2 weeks ago. Few of us, not all of us, are here. So I want to also thank them for doing the whole work that I'm presenting here. Thank you very much for your attention.